1958, the year he joined the Indian Armed Service. Council the name known. I read his book, The Odyssey of a Diplomat, with very great interest. I can't hear you.
Can't hear me. Now
I can hear you.
Namaskar, batayega. I am ready.
Should I begin again?
Yes, I'm fine. Thank you, sir.
So, Lakhan, I've known you since 1958, and it's a very great pleasure to have known you all these years. When I read your book, The Odyssey of a Diplomat, with very, very great interest. I take some credit for your writing this book, because I remember telling you, after Chappie Mishra's book was released, Lakhan, you must write your autobiography. It will be a part of it.
Yes, I can hear you now. Can you hear me? आपकी तरफ से कोई
टेक्निकल?
Yes, sir, we can all hear you.
We are hearing you.
I can hear you too. Hello.
Okay. Let's start all over. Lakhan, I've known you since 1958. The year you joined the Foreign Service. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but now faintly. Earlier it was better.
Well, I begin again. Lakhan, no. I've known you since 1958, the year I recently read your autobiography, The Odyssey of a Diplomat, and I've enjoyed it very, very greatly indeed.
Hello. Hello,
yes.
Am I audible to you?
Yes, I am.
Am I?
Yes, you are audible to me.
Fine. Aapka, please continue.
Did you hear what I said?
I heard you say that you know me since I joined the Foreign Service in 1958. There is some problem on your side, on the technical side. The IIC technical team has to do something.
That's right. And then I said, the Odyssey of a Diplomat. Oh dear. Shyam, sir, what are you eating? Shyam?
Sir, we can hear you, sir.
No, it's not working.
Continue, because all of us can hear you quite clearly.
Can't hear you at all.
Could Mr. Natwar Singh have a loose connection somewhere or?
No, we can hear him. So I think he's.
I can hear him too.
He cannot hear, but I think somebody should tell him that he's quite audible and clear. I think we have lost him. So why don't you, sir? Why don't you introduce your book and say a few words, and then we can continue with the discussion.
Shall I? But I want to see the chairman online.
He doesn't seem to be there. Now he's coming back.
I can see
I think his connection gets frozen.
I think his connection has got something wrong.
No, my connection is okay.
Now it is better. Hello. Fabian, can you hear me?
I can hear you. We can hear all of you. The chair should continue with the opening remarks.
But the chair is not listening to us.
No, no, I think is the frame is frozen. From what I can see, that frame is frozen. So his connection is, I think, getting interrupted.
I think there is something wrong with this connection.
I think we should go in. Let's go ahead because people are watching, no?
Yeah. So I think why not the author, you know, introduce the book and then we can continue the discussion.
I'll give him half a minute more. Hello.
No, he's still frozen.
Hello.
Yes.
Are you back?
Yes.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
I think all the rest of us are all right.
Shyam, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Fabian, can you hear me?
We all can hear you, sir. Please continue.
I think his connection is getting interrupted again and again. I would suggest, Ambassador Malhotra, that you please start introducing your book, and then later on, if the connection improves, then we can come back to him.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
I shall do that.
Yeah.
You know, my I'm very grateful to IIC and to the panelists here today. For this discussion on my autobiography. I am especially grateful to Mr. Natwar Singh because 4 years ago when he released the book of Mr. S.K. Mishra, the former principal secretary, he walked up to me and said, Lakhan, next you should write your memoirs and that would be history. It is my fond hope that the book that is before you and that we are discussing today fulfills that promise in some measure. I have commenced the book with some vignettes from my early life and then moved on to the rest of my life and career. I was born in the little township of Ramnagar, district Nainital, nestled in the Tarai, on the way to Jim Corbett Sanctuary, a very little township of some 6,000 people. There were no facilities for education there to start with, but gradually a primary school came and then another school up to seventh grade. My mother was, however, determined that despite our financial difficulties and the fact that they were finding it, their both ends to meet very difficult, because of her efforts, we all in the family ended up with graduation at Allahabad University. This was a yeoman's job on her part, and I would like to take this opportunity to pay my homage to my parents who made me capable to join a service like the Indian Foreign Service later. My stints at Agra and Allahabad, Agra famous for the Taj and Allahabad for the Triveni, had a few notable facts. During my career as a student and a scholar and then as a teacher, I had the great good opportunity of visiting China as a member of the student teacher delegation representing Allahabad University as a scholar. That was out of the entire studentship of the university, and my little township felt so proud that they thought that on that very day I would cross some good frontiers in my career. My visit to China at that time changed my mind from remaining with the university on my teaching assignment and then join the foreign service if I could. I told my professor, that who was insisting that I didn't leave the university, that I would do so only if I was selected for the Indian Foreign Service. And I did not have much interest in the Indian Administrative Service. Fortunately for me, that came to happen in 1958. In 1955, when I visited China, I noticed a few trends which I found a little disturbing. That was just in a few months after the 1954 agreement had been signed. And there were some very critical articles on Tibet and Dalai Lama being called a traitor right at that time. PLA was already into Tibet for 5 years, and what they were doing was getting known to the world outside. So when I came home and addressed the India, the University Union, I made it very clear that I had my hunch that sometime or the other, India and China will run into a clash on the question of Tibet. This was my premonition at that time. But the visit to China also was responsible for my joining the Foreign Service, and I was delighted to know that ultimately we will be confirmed in the service after an interview with Prime Minister Nehru. Prime Minister Nehru asked me a very difficult question. He said that you have been a topper of Sanskrit. You have been teaching history and ancient history and culture. What will you do doing in the Indian Foreign Service? My reply to him was very clear and straightforward. I said, sir, I have gone through your discovery of India, and if I can read it correctly, nobody would know the history of India, particularly ancient history, better than you. And if with that knowledge and with that book to your credit, the discovery of India, you can be the Prime Minister of India and moreover the Foreign Minister of India too, I can aspire to be a member of the Indian Foreign Service. The Prime Minister asked me no more questions. A smile escaped his lips, and I found my name in the confirmed list of the Foreign Service of 8 from the entire country. The book that I have written covers a long canvas with my assignment, my first assignment in the China division in the ministry, and then my move to Sikkim, where Nathula provided the window on the happenings in Tibet. It was my responsibility given to me by Mr. Apa Pant, political officer, to make a summary of all the reports that we were getting from our four missions in Lhasa, Shigache, Gartok, and Yatung, and then make a summary for Delhi, which I believe used to go right up to the Prime Minister. I was very glad to be doing that job. But then I also saw that hundreds of refugees had started flowing into Sikkim and into other parts of India from Tibet. That situation in Tibet was really something that must cause great concern to any citizen of India, because Tibet lies as a buffer, used to lie as a buffer at that time, having functioned quite independently of China from 1911 almost to the to 1950 until the Chinese forces entered Lhasa. This was quite opposed to the promises that Chinese had given to our ambassador there and to Prime Minister personally. And then I found that they were moving on consistently from Lhasa towards our borders. And in 1959, when I was in Sikkim, they had come right up to Longju and occupied Longju. But after Nehru's insistence, they withdrew from Barahoti, from Shipki Pass, and from Longju. We hope that nothing further would happen, but the pressure of events in Tibet brought the Dalai Lama to India. And as the Prime Minister had desired that I should proceed to Gangtok to study Tibetan at the Institute of Tibetology to go ultimately to Lhasa, it was quite considered necessary that I follow those events very, very closely. But Dalai Lama's arrival in India changed the entire picture. Instead of going to Lhasa, I found myself as liaison officer with him in 1961. Prime Minister met him in Mussoorie, and my book covers in some detail the very important meeting that the Prime Minister had, and the very first one with the Dalai Lama in Mussoorie. Both of them dealt with questions of war and peace, and when the Dalai Lama informed him that just before coming into India, he had established a government of Tibet, which was an independent government of Tibet. The Prime Minister told him that we cannot recognize it because we cannot go to war with China. But the Dalai Lama in Dharamshala told me later that he won't be surprised if the Chinese attack India on the border. And lo and behold, in 1962, the attack came. The lesson for the book that I have written had one objective in my mind through and through, that it should be useful for the coming generations of the Indian Foreign Service. The lesson that I derived from those events, from Nehru's trust in the Chinese leadership and his trust in the future of Asia with China and India working together, was totally betrayed by the Chinese. The Chinese violated the Panjshir agreement with him in every respect possible. There was no respect for territorial integrity of India. There was no commitment to non-aggression. There was no commitment to mutual trust and mutual benefit or peaceful coexistence, because they committed war on India. The few pickets that Prime Minister Nehru had put on the Indo-Chinese frontier, ill-equipped and ill-connected, were described outside the world as India's foreign forward policy, and the Chinese took advantage of that. But the fact of the matter is that it was a premeditated aggression on India, and in which the Mao Zedong personally and Khrushchev had collaborated together. The situation in the world was reaching a boiling point on the issue of Cuba. And Khrushchev and his Politburo had decided that they would place the nuclear missiles in Cuba at the request of the Cuban Prime Minister, Mr. Castro. The Chinese were not going along with them. Then Khrushchev said that if you go along with us on that issue, we will resume the supply of petrol to your forces in Tibet, which we had stopped earlier. And without that, the Chinese could not carry out any aggression. So these were the underhand dealings that Mao was doing to fight a war with India. But in India, we were just not ready for it. And our pickets collapsed like a house of cards. And it took our army a long time to shed that humiliation, and the nation as a whole. But the nation as a whole rose like one man to support the Prime Minister at that time. And yet, in the midst of that, there were very critical statements in the Parliament of India, which the Prime Minister took in his stride and had the magnanimity to say that I take full responsibility for the military failure and the intelligence failure on India's part. He did not blame anybody else. He did not want to pass the blame on anyone else. He did not hide any facts from anyone else. He gave the entire picture with them, how the whole thing developed. Now, this is just the beginning of my book. Then I move on from Sikkim to the Dalai Lama. And when I was on my way from there to New York as Consul of India and as co-opted as First Secretary to the Permanent Mission of India to the United Nations, where I had the great good fortune of knowing Mr. Natwar Singh and partake of this great reserve of affection for me and my family. I must say that New York was a great experience. Kennedy was in power. He was a charismatic leader, but he had just dealt with the Cuban Missile Crisis in my time in his own fashion. In the teeth of opposition from the whole world, Kennedy said that war with the Soviet Union is not an easy matter. It will harm them, but it can harm us too. Equally, we must know that both of us are now nuclear weapon powers, and we have to move carefully in the matter. We must not negotiate with them out of fear, but we must not fear to negotiate. And in the midst of opposition, he started a line with Khrushchev, Dobrynin with Bob Kennedy, and ultimately peace came to the Western Hemisphere. We were moved, humanity moved away from the brink of war at that particular time. From there, I had the great good opportunity of being posted to Cuba. And in Cuba, I came firsthand with the situation that had arisen in the aftermath of the missile crisis and the Bay of Pigs invasion. I met Castro, I met Che Guevara, I studied the whole and reported how our relations could shape up with Cuba at that time, which was isolated by the West, but which had come very much closer to the East. At the same time, I had an appointment, an interim assignment in Mexico, because Mr. Niranjan Singh Gill was going to take time to come as ambassador there, the man very famous for the INA. And in between, I learned a few lessons from Mexican foreign policy. They were part of the Association of American Association of States, but they refused to attach themselves to the apron strings of America. And they were sympathetic towards non-aligned movement. There were constant exchanges between Mexico and India at that time, and they came in first as observers. Now, Nehru's policy of non-alignment was very highly criticized in USA, not only by the Dalesian coterie, but in the American diplomatic service, but also by the people who did not trust India because of its non-aligned policy. But Kennedy, both as a professor earlier and later as president, emphasized the fact that it was a democracy, and that the non-aligned movement had taken a big chunk of the world from out of the rising clutches of the world communist movement under the leadership of the Soviet Union. And therefore, Nehru was doing great service to India. And he welcomed Nehru as the Lincoln of the East in Washington. But when the war came in 1962, Prime Minister Nehru, in a little departure from his policy of non-alignment, knocked at the doors of America, asked for military equipment, which he supplied in the first instance. But when the request came from him for F-16s, he placed the condition that we have given F-16s to Pakistan because it is an ally, it is a formal military ally, but we will not refuse them to you if you settle the Kashmir question. Now, with that, he started talks with Pakistan for settlement of the Kashmir question, but they came to nothing at that time in 1964. On the other hand, in 1965, as my book will detail in great detail, there was a war. Pakistan attacked us, occupied Akhnoor in India, and we went and the United Nations Security Council wanted to pass resolutions putting India and Pakistan in balance. Our diplomacy was at its best. Mr. Narwar Singh will bear me out because he played a very important role at that time. When we convinced not just the Soviet Union, which was quite friendly towards us, but USA, that the war was started by Pakistan, that Pakistan should go back to the lines which they had occupied before the war. And finally, the resolution that came out of UNSC and with India and Pakistan both accepted that position, forced Pakistan to withdraw, and then Kosygin invited Lal Bahadur Shastri and Ayub Khan to Tashkent. Unfortunately, after signing the Tashkent Declaration, great Indian leader, the initiator of Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan, Shastriji's, left us, and shocked us by his demise. The book contains all the details in the aftermath of the Tashkent Agreement, and I was shifted from New York to Moscow at that time. As the book will give you full details of the occasion, the Politburo Khrushchev had been summarily discussed by the Politburo, and Brezhnev, a more moderate leader and more inclined towards collective leadership, was given charge of the country and the party. All these details are there in my book. From there, I moved on to back to India, where I was witness to some turning points of India's history. First, Indira Congress was formed. Then I 1971 came. And in 1971, Mr. Swaran Singh and the Prime Minister placed a very great responsibility on shoulders of the Indian diplomacy, of the Indian Ministry of External Affairs. We were told point blank by Mr. Swaran Singh in a meeting of all heads of divisions that the things are taking shape. We do not know whether there will be a peaceful solution to Pakistan's troubles in East Bengal, and we must prepare for the eventuality of a war. In that eventuality, it will be the responsibility of every head of mission in India to convince the world that if Bangladesh is formed, it is not because India had wanted it, it is not because India had assisted it, but entirely because of the folly of Pakistan in the other half of its body politic. So we did all that. But my point, as the book will tell you, is that the Indian diplomatic service and the Indian diplomatic force was able to module itself to the requirements each time of the international situation as it shaped itself and is confronting India. The world is all the time evolving. Things do not remain the same. The world is dynamic. It is not static, and international relationships will continue to change. My first important lesson for it was when I was posted in China. And in China, the Mao Zedong had come out with a revolutionary transformation of the foreign policy of China. From being the closest friend of the Soviet Union, they became the closest ally of the United States of America. And Soviet Union became their enemy number one. You can imagine at the back of this was their lust for power, their proclivity to be treacherous to a friend, what the Soviet Union had done for them was put into oblivion, obliterated altogether from their history book, and Soviet Union was branded as a traitor to the cause of China, of rising China. It was also branded as a declining superpower, whose decline was certain and ultimately the Chinese saw to it, and with the help of Americans, and the Americans with the help of the Chinese, that the Soviet Union disintegrated later. But that is another part of the story which is fully covered in my book. And there again, we have made prompt adjustments. Indira Gandhi moved forward, Chu Enlai responded, and we started the process of normalization with China ourselves as a change of policy. Then, when the Soviet Union broke up, then again there was a change of policy, and we moved a little towards the USA to put our policies, not just our policies in balance, but their attitudes towards us in balance. The Americans had thought that we were an all-season friend of the Soviet Union and will never deviate from their policies. But in Afghanistan, they saw, my book elaborates it fully, they saw that India sent Brezhnev empty-handed when he came running to Indira Gandhi for support on Afghanistan, to Delhi. And therefore, our policies, though there have been some constants, we have shown the capacity to change every time when the change was required. And my submission to my junior colleagues, my coming generations of the Indian Foreign Service, would be that if they find the time, they should make it possible for themselves to have a look at this book. There are many lessons to learn from this book, and my main object, I would feel highly blessed if I find my fellow members of the Indian Foreign Service and every student of foreign policy in India to find my book of some value. It ends with a poem, the book of human life opens for a while and then closes at its own time. Today we are meeting in the shadow of the demise of a very distinguished colleague of ours, of all of us present here as panelists, Sri Gajashankar Bajpayee. We do not know when the end will come, but there is a universal urge in all of us and everywhere in every part of humanity that our end should be peaceful. My last dream represents that urge. And just as it has a universal value, I fondly hope, as I said in the beginning, that my book too would have such a value for the coming generations. Thank you very much indeed. I greatly look forward to the comments of other panelists who have taken all the trouble to come, and especially Chairman Mr. Natwar Singh, उनको बहुत बहुत उन्होंने जहमत उठाई है, इसके लिए मैं उनको हृदय से आभारी हूँ। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
Lakhan, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Well, I've known you since 1958 when you joined the Foreign Service. And we've been close friends ever since. And we met in different parts of the world.
I agree. I could not agree more. You have been a great source of inspiration to me. And I owe this book entirely to you.
I think we have lost the chairman again.
No, some parts of your book reveal things of which Shyam Saran is aware at all. But I'll point out one or two incidents very much. First of all, going to the Antarctic, I was the only officer. Landed there and come back safe. The other thing I remember is your meeting Chon Lai at a banquet given by Chon Lai for Mr. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. And before the banquet or between in the banquet, Chon Lai came and tapped you on your shoulder, and something very rare.
Yes.
And he said, tell Indra not to worry, it'll all be all right.
Exactly.
I found that absolutely. And also your description of the Soviet leadership after the death of Khrushchev. The way you delineate the character of Brezhnev from a sprightly 60-year-old man to a decrepit man who 82, who could hardly hear. But the most amusing part I found in the book was when Maji Desai came to Francisco when you were Secretary General.
Exactly.
And I'll read it out because I had a similar experience with him. He said, I had received instructed water and non-pasteurized cow's milk. The nearest source of the supply of coconuts was Hawaii, but all vegetable imports into California, including from Hawaii, were banned. Similarly, production and consumption of non-pasteurized milk was banned in the state. To resolve the situation,
गीता
I think we have lost Mr. Natwar Singh again. Shall we move ahead with the program? I think if Ambassador Fabian can step in and act as moderator for the time being.
Yes, I was thinking, Shyam, maybe you'd like to speak now.
Okay, with your permission, and let me while the chairman is getting his internet restored. So first of all, I would like to offer my very warm congratulations to Ambassador Lakhan Mehrotra on the publication of this very fine autobiography entitled "The Odyssey of a Diplomat." And as you would have seen in the introduction to the book, I have also drawn attention to the fact that Ambassador Mehrotra has had the distinction of being a kind of eyewitness to a number of very seminal events in the contemporary history of India. And not only as a witness, but in fact, also as a participant, as an actor in several of these important developments in India's foreign policy. So this is a very valuable book in that respect, and I can assure Ambassador Mehrotra that his younger colleagues, in which amongst whom I include myself, would find this book a very, very useful point of reference, and also a book which provides a certain very, very, very useful insights in the making of India's foreign policy. How has India adjusted to what has been a very, very dramatic transformation in the international environment? And as was pointed out by the chairman, when he read out the excerpt from the book relating to how Ambassador Lakhan Mehrotra had to prepare for the visit of Prime Minister Morarji Desai, that diplomats like us are called to do a lot of multitasking. So it's not only just foreign policy, but there are a lot of other things that we have to take care of as well. The dietary requirements of VIPs, we have to sometimes, you know, be very, very sensitive to the egos of some of the major, actors whom we come across during our career. So this book, in a sense, very much reflects the kind of demands that are made on Indian diplomats and Indian diplomacy. So from that point of view, I found this book certainly a very, very rewarding one. Secondly, my association with Ambassador Mehrotra goes back to the very early years of my career in the Foreign Service. After I had finished my language study of Mandarin in Hong Kong, that was from 1971 to 1974, I was in Hong Kong, mainly as a probationer and as a student of the language. Thereafter, I went to China, where Ambassador Mehrotra was already there as the Charge d'Affaires. You know, this was a time when we did not have ambassadorial level relations. And even though I was a second secretary at that time, having been in service all of 3 years, in fact, I was the effective number two in the mission. And I must say that despite the fact that I was a very junior officer, Ambassador Mehrotra gave me, you know, full support and, let me exercise my responsibilities to the best of my ability. And I particularly remember this period because, there was the famous Tiananmen incident, the first Tiananmen incident. Of course, we had a second one in 1989. But in 1976 was the first Tiananmen incident, which occurred after the death of Premier Chou Enlai. And he was, of course, a very popular figure in China. So when the in April, the traditional Qingming festival, where, you know, you honor your ancestors and you sweep their graves, during that particular period, there was an outpouring of, you know, sort of remembrance of Chou Enlai, and that led to that first Tiananmen incident, where the leftist, you know, forces within the Chinese Communist Party, led by Mao's widow, Jiang Qing, in fact, launched a kind of a coup against Deng Xiaoping, who had just come back and was vice premier at that time. And during that period, you know, we were just two of the officers, Shankar Menon, who was also there as second secretary, and myself. We had, you know, occasion to go and mingle with the crowds at the Tiananmen Square, you know, talk to some of the young people there, read some of the posters. And it was a quite, in that sense, a very exciting experience. Of course, I remember Ambassador Malhotra getting quite, you know, nervous about our going to these events, because I think he has also referred to this incident in the book, that he was mindful of the fact that there had earlier been, you know, occasion where our diplomats were, you know, because of the fact that they were seen as ferreting out information and reading, you know, some of the big character posters. There was a reaction to that. So to that extent, it was a legitimate, you know, anxiety on his part. But I must say that that particular period where Mr. Malhotra was the CDA in Beijing was a very exciting time to be in China. And also the credit goes to him that in a sense, he prepared the ground for the exchange of ambassadors between the two countries after, you know, a gap of several years, almost 14 years since we had ambassadors in place. So Ambassador Malhotra left after accomplishing that important assignment. I later came across Ambassador Malhotra when I was posted as ambassador to Indonesia. And at that time, Ambassador Malhotra was the special envoy of the UN Secretary General for the, you know, to handle the transition of East Timor from a UN mandated territory to independence. And he was stationed in Jakarta, and he had this very sensitive and rather delicate job of, you know, dealing with Indonesia. And of course, the East Timor leaders, and also the United Nations. And I must say that from whatever I learned of his contribution there, he did an excellent job in that managing that trajectory of East Timor towards independence. So he has covered that as well. Before that, of course, he was also special envoy of the UN Secretary General for Cambodia. And also for you know, managed and oversaw the political transition there. So in terms of, you know, really being very much involved in some of these very important you know, historical moments during the last several years, Ambassador Malhotra has played a very important role. Finally, I would like to draw attention to the fact that he was our High Commissioner in Sri Lanka, another very sensitive position. And there, he was given the job of managing the withdrawal of the IPKF, the Indian Peacekeeping Force. And that too was a very difficult assignment. And I must say, that that was assignment also that Ambassador Malhotra handled with great finesse. So let me conclude here by once again congratulating Ambassador Malhotra on the publication of a very fine autobiography, and also for providing for us a historical sort of material which will be of great use for younger diplomats who wish to understand how India has managed its foreign policy over the last several years. You know, the after independence, India's you know, external relations were a great challenge, you know, for a newly emerging, newly independent country. And even though the Indian Foreign Service has even now been constituted by a rather small number of active diplomats, even today, despite the fact that India has such expansive, you know, engagement with the rest of the world, we have just barely about 1,000 diplomats. The figure was only 260 or 270 when I joined service in 1970. And it is to the credit of the first and second generation of our, you know, Indian Foreign Service, you know, colleagues, our seniors, that they very skillfully and very efficiently manage the foreign relations of India. And that, of course, includes Mr. Natwar Singh. I had the privilege of serving as Foreign Secretary when Shri Natwar Singh Ji was the External Affairs Minister. And I profited greatly from his guidance and his wisdom. And similarly, I would like to pay tribute to Ambassador Malhotra, because again, during a very formative period of my career in the Foreign Service, I had the privilege of serving under his leadership. So once again, sir, great congratulations to you. And I hope this will be the first of several books that we will see emerging from your pen. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Shyam Saran, for your remarks.
Now, if the chair permits, I will speak. I think there is a problem with connectivity. Well, respected chair, distinguished author, distinguished fellow discussant, chief librarian of the IAC who brought all of us together, and the publisher of the book, friends, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon and happy Onam. Now, you know, it is rather difficult to make a speech after the Onasadhya. So in Kerala, we do not have any speech after the Onasadhya, but we have only a conversation. And that is what I shall attempt. Now, the very title fascinated me. And I wanted to ask the author, how did he think of the title, The Odyssey? Because the dictionary meaning of Odyssey, the Merriam-Webster dictionary gives three meanings. And the last meaning, the third meaning, which I found is relevant, it means intellectual or spiritual quest. Now, this is a book which can help the reader in his or her intellectual or spiritual quest in understanding India, you know, because we can understand what is the current India only when we understand better what it was before. Now, the author was born in 1934. That makes it, he was 13 in 1947. So one might say that he was present at the creation. I found the narration compelling. You know what he says about his grandfather? And then he takes us all the way back to Alexander the Great. I had always thought, without anyone's telling me, that Ramnagar was named after Lord Rama. But I learned that it was named after Sir Henry Ramsay, the chief commissioner. I was thrilled to read that the author had his darshan of Mahatma Gandhi immediately after the Quit India movement of 1942. And that was August 1942. And I asked myself, what happened this year in August? Did the media or anyone else in our society tell us anything about it? Well, there is a disconnect between history and a part of the present generation. And this book will be of great help in doing some reconnection. The author tells us his recalling Nehru's defense of Netaji. Now, those who want to spread the fiction that the two great leaders of India were enemies, well, they should read this. And he tells us of the 60 rupee scholarship which he got at the Allahabad University. And he has already told us of his going to China in 1951. Now, PRC was established in 49. So our author was present at the second anniversary of the PRC. And he has told us a lot in the book and also in his speech about China. Now, today we read about another skirmish between Indian and Chinese troops at the border. So it is comforting for us, the readers, to know that there are, you know, individuals like the author who know their China fairly well, and the government have the option to consult them. Now, in 51, when the author was, well, that will make him 34, 17, he met, he was received by Mao Zedong. Well, and he was destined to meet many leaders in high positions. And the beauty is that he could converse and walk with the kings and common people with equal grace and ease. I could have said more, but I see that it is almost 5 o'clock, and the next item on the program is Q&A. So let me stop here and let us move on to the Q&A. But before that, I wanted to request the publisher, Himanshu Chawla, to say a few words about the book, because without the publisher, there will be no book at all. So over to you, Himanshu.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. Honorable members of the chair, Shri Natwar Singh Ji, Ambassador Shyam Saran Ji, Ambassador Fabian, Ambassador Lakhan Marotra, I am indeed honored to be a part of this virtual book discussion. When I started reading Ambassador Marotra's manuscript, I felt that the real life incidents narrated by Ambassador Marotra were exceptional, and was fascinated to read how he, as a diplomat, had contributed to a number of history-making events that have shaped the course of our nation and formed India's foreign policy. During his role, the LTT and IPKF confrontation in Sri Lanka, to his stay in Moscow in early 1980s during the Soviet intervention in Afghanistan, and signing of the Agreement of Scientific and Technical Cooperation between India and Argentina. Ambassador Mehrotra has had a career in diplomacy which has been par excellence. His efforts as a diplomat have been instrumental in forging strategic partnerships with nations across the world, both politically and otherwise. He not only helped to promote India in the field of heritage and culture, but also promoted India's interest by signing agreements with Western nations in the field of science and technology. As a publisher, I feel privileged to have published The Odyssey of a Diplomat through the corridors of time. I indeed thank Ambassador Mehrotra for choosing Heritage Publishers for publication of this very important work on diplomacy, politics, and above all, a very well-written personal journey. For the convenience of our audience, I would like to inform everyone present on this virtual book discussion that the book is available on Amazon, Snapdeal, and Flipkart. It is also available at select bookshops in New Delhi, including Om Books, Bhari Sons, Khan Market, Midland Bookshop, and South Extension. I once again thank honorable members of the chair and all the audience present here for attending the virtual book discussion organized by India International Center. With these words, I would like to conclude and pass on the proceedings to the chair.
Thank you, Himanshu. We shall now take some of the questions. Ambassador Mehrotra, there are a number of messages congratulating you, but let me just repeat two of the questions that have come my way. One is from Usha, New Delhi. It seems the Chinese have always duped India at every step. What reason is there for us to believe that this time around things will be different? Now, the second question is from Pramod Mishra, Delhi. You began by stating quite clearly that the Chinese betrayed our trust in 1962. Do you think we can trust them now? Can we coexist as good neighbors? Perhaps you may like to answer these two questions before we collect more.
Well, I have missed no words. I have talked of China's treachery against their not only the closest friend and neighbor, the Soviet Union, but they have degraded them, insulted them, moved into their territory, and there was a war, a very short war between the Soviet Union and China. Soviet Union on the Ussuri River. Kosygin told Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee when he was visiting there that, Mr. Prime Minister, we ended all controversy with China by blowing up that island itself. They were making a claim on it. We were already there. We had always been there. And they wanted us to move away. So we just blew up the island. The Soviet Union was a country, but not just a country. It was the Soviet Communist Party which laid the foundations of the Chinese Communist Party. And it was the Soviet Union which helped them move triumphantly into Peking, when they made Peking into their capital instead of Nanking. It supported them. They called it names. They went to war with it. They wanted to occupy its territory. And that is what the Chinese are. Today, we have a rehash of what happened to India in 1962. Nehru trusted them. He was confident that a new Asia was in the making with the coming up of China and India. And as friends, they could transform the destiny of billions of people in our continent. They signed a Panchsheel Agreement, an agreement for peaceful coexistence between nations, committed themselves to it fully, and then violated every part of its agreement, all the five pillars of peaceful coexistence. Today too, Mr. Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, has tried his level best to strike a very good chord with the leadership of China. She came to India, he went to China, and they were all talking of the Wuhan spirit, as they used to talk of India, Hindi, Chini, Bhai Bhai in 1954-55. Where is the Wuhan spirit now? And where are they? They occupied the Galwan Valley in 1962 also. And it was only after pressure from the Colombo powers, the five Colombo powers who negotiated between India and China for peace in the region, that they came to terms with us and they withdrew from the territories that they had occupied. They ordered a unilateral ceasefire, but the withdrawal of their troops from our territories came much later. They signed a trade agreement with us on Tibet. And they occupied the very posts which were mentioned as border posts in that agreement. What more can I say on the subject? Today they are in areas which are not theirs, which they did not claim earlier. They never laid a claim on Pangong So. They are in occupation of that territory. They never laid a claim on the Dapsang Plateau. They are occupying that plateau. They use exactly the same tactics, my dear friends, which they did at that time. A seven-pronged attack at the same time on all along the frontier posts. This time, they did not come into Aksai Chin alone, but they made intrusions or tried to make intrusions all along our northern border and eastern border. We must be aware of what the Chinese are. Don't trust them, but deal with them because they are there and because they are our neighbor, and they are a very important neighbor for us and a very important emerging power in the world. But we must learn from them. They do not go to war without weighing their options and without weighing their power. They wait until they are equal to the situation, and then they come out pounding and pouncing and with a menacing attack on others' territories. They're what the Germans call Lebensraum. It is enormous. Their expansionist power tendency, at any point of time when they can expand into any region, their history tells us that they will go and occupy. That is what my prediction is. It was my prediction in 1955, and it was my prediction after 1962. And it was my warning even after we were not liking it, and I said, don't trust them. When the Americans were raised in America and China was recognized by Carter, I told the World Affairs Council there, please do what you want, but don't trust them. That lesson I have learned, I have learned it very strongly, very intimately, and I will not part with it. What our government will do, how it will follow these events, how it will emerge out of it, I cannot say. I cannot look into the mirror of the future anymore. But I hope that we will emerge out of this situation too, as we have emerged out of every other situation with flying colors. Thank you so much. 1962 was avenged later when we showed them our power on several border clashes, and every time they have beaten a retreat. This time what they will do, I do not know. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Mehrotra. I find many complimentary messages, but no questions as such. So now it is for the chair to make his concluding remarks.
Well, I have been very privileged to be a part of this occasion, particularly to have discussions with eminent former colleagues of the Foreign Service on Dakhan's book. And I'm sure that this book will sell very well. And I would request Shyam Saran and Fabian to tell all the colleagues in the Foreign Service and all their friends, they needn't read the book, but they must buy it. Thank you.
I would.
And Lakhan, good luck.
I would like to take the opportunity to personally thank the chairman for his presence, for all the trouble that he has taken, for all the inspiration that he has provided, for all the affection that he has extended to me from day one when I came to know him in 1962. I'm most grateful to IIC, to Ambassador Fabian, to Ambassador Shyam Saran, for all the kind words that they have said about me and about my book. And I can only say that it has been a rare privilege for me to have had colleagues like them. Just as that, it has been a rare privilege for me to meet and to get to know and to savor of the affection and kindness of the chairman, Honorable Natwar Singh. I have learned a lot from him. I have worked with him many a time. He has used me and my services for missions that were difficult, even after my retirement. Even Mr. Shyam Saran would bear it out, and I hope that I did not ever disappoint him. Thank you ever so much, and thank you IIC, thank you Usha Ji, thank you Ms. Shefali, and thank you all those who have been associated with this, organizing this. Very friendly and informative event about my book. I also thank the publisher who published my book as a mission and as promptly as they could, within a matter of 3 months after my giving them this. This is unusual, and if it was held up, it was only held up because all the presses were closed during the corona time. Thank you so much once again. Thank you.